interesting, I asked the doctor why it still hurts so much. And he tried to explain my ribs like the ribs on a pig. He said, you know, if you ever had barbecue ribs, and when you see how neat they stick together, he says, so when you poke something through, it's okay. Yeah. It's okay, Lord. Everybody's a comedian. I haven't made it yet. I know that we've been studying types since middle two, praise the Lord. But this past week, spending time with the Lord, a lot of time, and praise God for that. He stopped me at Luke 12. I want to be a blessing to you. Sometimes I wonder about our fundamental churches, independent fundamental churches. Right. Sometimes we are so afraid of other people trying to interject their ideas and thoughts into our minds. And so we get a little, protective of God's Word. We don't have to. Amen? God's Word is God's Word. It doesn't matter how you feel about it.
Right.
Amen? So we're going to read Luke 12, starting verse 1. It says, in the meantime, when there were gathered together an innumerable multitude of people. That's a lot of people. It's so much that they trod one upon another. He began to say unto his disciples, first of all, let me get back here. Let me start this over again. Got to get my mind right with the Lord. In the meantime, when they were gathered together an innumerable multitude of people, insomuch that they trod one upon another, he began to say unto his disciples, first of all, beware ye of the leaven of the Pharisees, which is hypocrisy. For it said, there is nothing covered that shall not be revealed, neither hid that shall not be known. Therefore, whatsoever ye have spoken in darkness shall be heard in the light. And that which he has spoken in the air and closets shall be proclaimed upon the housetops. Imagine that. And I say unto you, my friends, wow, be not afraid of them that kill the body, and after that have no more that they can do. But let's go ahead and have prayer right there. Brother Charles, pray for us. Yes, Lord. Good, that's good. Tom Cruise?
Jaws.
Well, at least you folks aren't caught up in that stuff. There's Star Trek and some of these other great things. What was that? Star Wars. But I was trying to focus on this multitude of people, more than they could count. Jesus is there in the midst of them. I think we preached about it on Sunday a little bit. But they were following the Lord Jesus.
Yes, sir.
As we understand it, saying in Luke 12:1, right? Mm-hmm. So I would say, maybe I'm wrong in this, but I would say that they were probably token followers.
Right.
Yeah. They were people that were waiting upon the ministry of the Lord Jesus Christ to be able to perform something for themselves. They enjoyed, I believe, as I've been saying, just the popular feeling of being in the presence of a popular person. Amen?
Yeah.
And so popularity has a lot to do with what happens today in most things. Am I right in saying that?
Yes, sir.
If you're popular enough, you can go ahead and accomplish just about anything. If you have enough charisma, you can accomplish great things in your life. At least it seems like you can.
Right.
Amen? But people following you is not always a good thing.
Right.
And even as I follow the Lord, I'd rather have people follow me or not be with the Lord.
Amen.
Amen. Yeah. Follow me as I follow the Lord, but follow the Lord Jesus Christ and Him alone. Amen. So why are we here tonight? Well, obviously it's not a popularity contest, because if it was, we'd have all kinds of spectators and people trying to knock doors down. Amen. To enjoy the part of a ministry that's popular to people. And I won't get into all those, but there's two classes of people I want to talk about tonight, and I think you're very familiar with it. Seems like that's all we talk about lately, but the first are there because of the idea of being popular. Going to church, obviously, is not as popular as it used to be.
Right.
Is it? I mean, honestly, if it was, there'd be a lot more people here tonight, but I know there's people that are sick, and we're praying for them. Amen. But there are second group of people that mean business. Now tonight, I believe that you that are here mean business. You're not here because of me or anybody else. You're here to hear the Word of God, and you can certainly read the Word of God to yourself at home. And we all do, hopefully. And we all want to get something out of the Word of God. Isn't that the truth? But we are here together because we're serious about who we are in the Lord Jesus Christ. That is, I am claiming to be a disciple of Christ.
Right.
So Christ didn't turn around and talk to the multitude.
No.
What he did is he talked to the disciples in the midst of the multitude. That's an amazing thought tonight when you think about your relationship with Christ.
Right.
There's all kinds of things going on around us. Mm-hmm. You know that.
Yeah.
And so isn't it neat to know that Christ is really concerned with you, with myself,
right,
as an individual? He's not concerned with how many people are following him.
Right.
He's concerned with where we are with him in our life. Amen? That's an individual thing.
Yes,
I like that. Amen? So I don't have to make you happy.
Amen.
In order to make the Lord happy.
That's right.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
So American churches today, I believe, are like, if you will, these, now I don't go to them, wine tester places, or wine taster places. You all know what I'm talking about? Amen. They ought to go to the wine tasting places to go ahead and act like they know what they're tasting, and roll it around in a glass, and if they like it, they'll drink it, and then they'll be sold to go ahead and buy a bottle of Boudin for $200. I don't know. That's a Christian wine. Never mind. You understand what I'm saying? And so likewise it is with the American church today, is that it has to be able to meet my taste requirements, even though I don't know what they are. Amen? Now I know that there are people that probably are great at tasting wine for whatever reason, and they know how old it is, and they know all those things that are particular about that type of wine, and that's fine. I'm not suggesting that you drink wine, but sometimes our churches are like that.
Right.
Amen?
That's right.
And that's what people are looking for. They might come in here tonight and they want to test us out.
There you
go. Amen.
Yep.
See what we taste like.
Right.
Run it through the you know, the doctrines that they have in their head. Amen.
Yep.
And that's the way it is.
Yep.
But I look at what Jesus wants from me, and he said, Bruce, I want you to be a disciple.
Right.
So really? A real disciple. Now, you can put that as a label on your back and say that you're somebody in the Lord.
Right.
But nonetheless, Jesus wants me to be a disciple. He said, I want you to yoke up with me.
Amen.
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 I want you to bear some of these burdens. Amen. I want you to accept my disciplines.
Right.
That's what the Lord is saying. The Lord has some disciplines.
Yes, sir.
Do I like them all? And I'm not talking about being disciplined. I'm talking about disciplines
right.
when it comes to the Word of God. Did I really feel like studying the Word of God as I was moaning? Anna told me to show up a few times, but... Amen. Feel sorry for me. Amen. You know, you can make a lot of excuses. But Jesus is telling us that we have to stop covering ourselves
Amen.
With this cloak of Christianity,
Amen.
Making it seem like everything is okay. Because we do come to church, because we do read the Word of God, somehow I think the American Christian has come to a place where they think that they've arrived with God, thinking that somehow they have found favor in God's eyes because of all the good things that they do. And I'm not saying that we don't do good things, amen? But Jesus is saying, you know, why don't you just take that cloak off for a little while, tonight when you go home. You know, lay it out someplace, and if you want to lift it up later, get along by yourself. They start talking, Lord, about your humanity or your immortality. Start talking to him about those things that mean something to you.
Right.
Now, most of us are going to say, my children mean a lot to me. But when you have problems in your life, all of a sudden they can even go on that. You know, if you can be set back a little bit. Or if you have maybe job issues or whatever else.
Right.
You know, we're always worried about those things.
Sure.
Amen. But then again, we always think that God, you know, we kind of think in the back of our heads that God owes us something.
Yep.
Amen. And if we really look at who we are as disciples of Christ, and we do call ourselves disciples, don't we?
Amen.
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 Are you a disciple tonight?
Yes, sir. Amen.
Are you sure?
Amen.
So then, as a disciple, we ought not to hide our Christianity and custom, but to demonstrate our Christianity in what God has laid out for us in His Word.
Amen.
Now, He said here in verse 2 of Luke 12, don't worry about my breathing, it just hurts. For there is nothing covered. You notice that?
Yes, sir.
Now, do you believe that?
Yes, sir.
Really?
Yeah.
My word. If that were true, I imagine how we would be around other folks.
Right.
I wonder those things that we hide over here, how we reveal them over there.
Right.
And the Lord is making it clear, He said, that shall not be revealed.
Right.
Amen? For there is nothing covered that shall not be revealed. That means everything in this physical body is going to be revealed. It says, neither give that shall not be known.
Right.
So that's kind of a put me in a place like, really, Lord? One day, whatever it is in my life, somebody else might discover. Did you know that when people get older, that when they do, if they do make it into the old age homes, and praise God that they can, but usually all those things that they've been hiding in their life start to reveal themselves in old age. And how embarrassing must that be? And, you know, I have to say, never mind, we'll go there. About old age homes, but anyway. Some of the most wicked and hideous things can come out of old age homes.
Oh, yes.
It's only because of what's been practiced in the flesh and they're not given to the Lord, revealed in the flesh. Romans 1:17, I want to take you there tonight. For therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to what?
Faith.
So as a disciple, faith needs to be an absolute product of my life.
Right.
It needs to be the essence of what I believe in the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
As it is written, the just shall live by
faith.
Faith. That's what the Bible says.
Yes, sir.
Now, what do you mean by faith? Well, does that mean that God shall supply all my need? And we often hear that preached.
Yep.
But if God is not supplying my need, what's the first thing that I do in my life? Is I take a different road until I get God to see it my way, and then get God to start supplying my need according to how I think He ought to see it.
Yeah.
Amen? And people just don't realize this, but we all go through it from one time or another. In verse 18, it says, for the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who hold the truth in unrighteousness.
That's right.
Scares me.
Yes.
This is the truth.
Yes, sir.
Amen. And barring what everybody else does with it, I'm held accountable in my own personal life to believe what it says, to practice what it says, and to understand where it's bringing me.
Right.
And so often we have in Christianity today is a lack of desire to allow the Word of God to go ahead and bring us to that place where we can actually be the one that's speaking to Jesus and the multitude standing behind us.
Right.
We need to be those where Christ is actually addressing us. Right now the Lord has got my attention.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Amen. As He should have.
Yes.
Should He have it all the time? Absolutely. But sometimes we just become human.
Okay.
Amen.
Yeah.
And so the Lord revealed to me again here in verse 3 of Luke 12. It says, therefore, whatsoever is spoken in darkness shall be heard in the light. I'm going to talk about that for a moment, preach about it if the Lord allows me. And that which he has spoken in the ear, in the closet, shall be what? Housetops. Nothing that you say in secret to somebody else is going to be able to be held secret.
Right.
Because first of all, they receive what you've said to them.
Yes.
Now you've opened yourself up for the devilish attacks that the devil can do upon you as a child of God.
Right.
Amen? You say, well, can I tell people what's going on in my life? Well, of course you can. I mean, that's entirely up to you.
Yep.
But you're opening yourself up
yep.
for destruction.
Yep.
You really are. Does that mean, Pastor, you don't trust anybody? There's certain things I don't trust with everybody.
Right.
Amen? But there are things that I do trust, in particular with my wife. I'll tell my wife just about everything.
Right.
And praise God for that. Amen?
Amen?
But there's just some things that most people would not be able to handle.
Right.
At least I don't think they would be able
Amen.
To. Amen? Whether it's good or bad.
Right.
So I have to be careful about what I'm saying.
Amen.
In darkness.
Right.
In darkness.
Yeah.
That means sometimes we can be talking to somebody when nobody else is around. And in particular, young people have to be careful of this.
Amen.
Because they'll say things in the flesh.
Yeah.
That they'll enlighten on the flesh those things that they desire to the point where they'll even act them out.
Yep.
Amen? And the unfortunate thing with that is that it will be found out.
Right.
Sooner or later, somebody will find you out,
yes, sir.
Or you will be found out because you'll act it out.
Right.
Amen?
Amen?
And so it's going to be revealed. So what I would say tonight, those of us that have been revealing things and saying things that sometimes even not true, they're just desires that we have
right.
within our heart. That's what's wrong with social media today. Is that when people get on social media, they lie about their character,
oh, yeah.
they lie about who they are, they even lie about what they look like.
Right.
Amen?
Oh, yeah.
I mean, they use all that social media to go ahead and use what's laying deep within their heart to be
right.
revealed. And God is just saying, hey, listen,
right.
it's going to catch you.
It will. Yeah.
And in particular, if you're a child of God, be aware that when it comes down, it's not going to be good. And when it does come down, it's not only going to hurt you, but it's going to hurt those that love you.
Right.
It's going to hurt those that are in your realm of life.
Amen.
It's just going to do it that way.
Yes.
How often have we heard men of God that have fallen by the sword because of those things they've allowed to happen in their life?
Amen.
Ministry is not easy. There's always a proposition, and there's always an opportunity. Always.
Yes.
And you have to be aware of it. Amen. You have to reveal it to God.
Right.
And then he says in verse 4, I say unto you, my friends. Wow. Isn't that neat? He's still speaking to the disciples. I learned as I was studying, the disciples were the big Christ. They liked to go around all their teachers.
Right.
Amen?
Amen?
And in Christ's day, they would go in great lengths to sacrifice in order to know and to love that what it was teaching them.
Right.
They would do whatever it took. Amen?
Amen?
And so often today we have in Christianity the Christ that we love.
Yeah.
He doesn't even fit the bill.
Right.
It's terrible, isn't it?
Right.
So what is a disciple? I wrote these four things down. It's probably nothing new. I believe a disciple is saying that I believe his doctrines.
Amen?
Amen.
Amen.
Whatever it might be. You know, you might believe in, what's that guy? I can't remember his name, but there's a Bruce. Something like that. Bruce Springsteen? Or something like that. People follow him. People follow all kinds of people.
Yeah.
And they become disciples of him.
Right.
What was the name of that guy that murdered? Had,
yeah.
No, the other one. Manson?
Charles Manson.
Charles Manson. I mean, he had disciples.
Charlie.
He had disciples, did he not?
Yeah.
Yeah, could you imagine young ladies giving themselves over to an insane dictator, a crazy, about himself person? And they would follow his doctrines? Well, they believe what he said.
Right.
Of course, as a disciple, I'm going to rest on the sacrifices that my teacher has given towards my discipleship. Amen? He has sacrificed for me.
Yeah.
And likewise, he has for you if you're a child of God. So what does that mean? If I'm going to have, if I'm going to be a disciple, I'm going to believe his doctrines.
Right.
I'm going to sacrifice or follow his sacrifice. And thirdly, I'm going to be absorbed in his spirit. Amen?
Amen.
The Lord says, abide in me.
Right.
Amen? We hear an awful lot about abiding.
Right.
We've heard a lot of messages about it, but I don't think we all know what it means to abide in Christ.
Right.
Amen? And he'll abide in us.
Right.
And of course, with that last thing, I wrote down, imitate his example.
Amen?
Amen? So that means, if I'm his disciple, I believe his doctrine. And of course, if I believe his doctrine, that means that I'm going to believe his sacrifice.
Right.
And then I'm going to want to be absorbed in who he is.
Right.
I thought about being with Jesus this past week.
Amen.
Wonderful.
Yes.
Amen? It'd be a great thing to be with my Lord and Savior. I'm not going yet.
Amen.
It's still going to be hard for you guys. And now I want to imitate it. It's hard to do, especially when you're in a hospital and you have all these doctors and crazy people running around. And you know, Lord saying, say something. Well, you're going to say nothing now. It's the best time in the world to say something. Sorry. Amen? It's a great time to do it. The disciple would also, I would say, be speaking about his master.
Amen?
All the time.
Yeah.
He'd be saying what he thinks about his master.
Amen?
How smart his master is. And how his master can deliver to him things that like nobody else can.
Right, right.
How he can teach me and how he can drive me.
Amen.
And how he can help me to do things he cares about me. Amen?
Yes.
Why? He's my master. He's my teacher.
Amen.
Then in verse 4, finishing up with verse 4. And I say unto you, my friends, thank you, Lord. He said, be not afraid of them that kill the body.
Right.
And after that, have no more that they can do. Praise God. I think the Lord was helping his disciples to see that fear was about to come. He said, well, there's no fear in Christianity. That's probably true nowadays.
That's right.
But it is going to come.
Amen.
He did say, be not afraid of them that can kill the body and if they have no more that they can do. That's an amazing thing. He guards. Now, this is what he's saying. He's saying, disciples, I'm guarding you against fear.
Right.
Now, often we associate fear with things that scare us.
Right.
And I like to scare people. Amen? I enjoy that. I haven't done it in a while because I've got rebuked several times. But nonetheless, I like to scare people. I like to see them jump out of their skin. Don't do that behind me, please. I'm trying to scare them. But the Lord is in here trying to, not trying to, but he's reminding us that fear is going to come. And we don't know how it's going to come, but it's going to come. And he's reminding them, he's saying, you know, there's something even worse than fear. Fear. There's worse things than fear.
Yes.
And that's to be condemned to hell from all eternity.
All right.
Amen. Conflict is one thing,
yeah,
but hell is forever.
Amen.
So conflict we can deal with from day to day.
Sure.
And then in verse 5 it says, but I will forewarn you whom ye shall fear.
Right.
Fear him which after death hath power to cast into hell.
Right.
Yea, I say unto you, fear him.
Amen.
Now he's telling us what we need to fear.
Right.
I'm afraid of hell.
Amen.
Every time I get closer to death, like most of us, the only thing that scares me more than fear itself is hell.
Right.
I always go through the situation of my salvation. I always talk to the Lord, and I know I have assurance because of what the Bible says.
Yeah.
Amen. There's no reason not to believe that.
Right.
But to go ahead and to have a feeling of being in hell is the scariest thing that any human being could ever experience.
Sure.
No matter how brave you think you are,
yeah,
once the door is shut and you're slammed behind it, and no one can open it again, you're there for all eternity.
Right.
And if you're not saved tonight, you need to get saved.
Yeah.
Amen. So what does he want to do? He wants to guard us not only from fear, but he wants to guard us even a little bit further, if you will. And let me show you how he's so sweet about this in verse 6. And he said in verse 6, and are not five sparrows sold for two farthings, and not one of them is forgotten by God or before God. But even the very hairs on your head, thank you, Lord, are all numbered.
Amen.
Fear not, therefore, ye are of more value than many sparrows. Also I say unto you, whosoever shall confess me before men, him shall the Son of God, shall man also confess him before the angels of God.
Right.
But he that denieth me before men shall be denied before the angels of God. Is that what it says?
Right.
And whosoever shall speak the word against the Son of Man, it shall be forgiven him. But unto him that blasphemeth against the Holy Ghost, it shall not be forgiven. I think it's significant here,
yeah,
that the Lord would lay these things out to try to give us comfort. Amen. He wants to take away all fear. And the only reason why we can be afraid of anything is because we haven't settled in our hearts our relationship with Jesus Christ.
Sorry.
As a disciple. I'm a disciple, Lord. I believe your doctrines. There is nothing that's written in here that can change my mind, that should change my mind, against my Lord. In other words, there's many books.
Sure.
And that's great. As I was talking to the doctor today, he said he read many books on apologetics. I said, that's great, but what about the book?
Right.
And he said, there's a lot of people who want to change things. He used King James. But I thought it was interesting that we would find ourselves in fear because we're not being disciples like we should be.
Right.
Fear only comes upon us, and I'm talking about the fear that God is talking about here, not fear of God.
Right, right.
Fear of dying, fear of disease,
yeah,
fear of loss, fear of so many things. Fear of losing a boyfriend, fear of losing a girlfriend,
like
speaking to our younger people. Well, I tell you what, praise the life of them, amen? Don't make a sense?
Yes.
We don't need all this stuff. So, how do I understand where I stand with God? Am I ashamed of him ever?
Right.
Am I able to confess him before men?
Right.
Without ever holding back?
Amen.
Because he said, if I confess him before men, he'll confess me before the angels.
Right.
Amen? So one of the things that can get us out of trouble is that when we're in the closet speaking all these dark things,
right,
we can say, can I confess that before the Lord?
Right.
Is that confessing God before who I'm talking to? Am I demonstrating my discipleship attitude towards the one I say I believe? The one that I've embraced and said I love? The one that I want to be around? The one that I want to emulate? The one that I say that he is my Lord and Savior? Do I really believe that?
Right.
Do I really hang on to that?
Right.
Because everything else is going to go ahead and blow away.
Yep.
No matter how you feel tonight.
Right.
You know, if you deny the Son, God's going to deny you. Well, you have opportunities to speak good things about your Lord or bad things about other people or yourself.
Right.
Amen? So if you deny the Son on the earth, He's going to deny you in heaven. That's what the Bible says.
Yes, sir.
So what's the greatest sin that we can ever profess or ever do, I guess? It's to blaspheme the Holy Ghost. And that means that we don't accept Christ as our Savior. There's a lot of doctrine tied to that, and I won't get into that tonight. But the fact of the matter is, if you're saved, you cannot blaspheme the Holy Ghost.
That's right.
If you can blaspheme the Holy Ghost, you never were saved.
Right.
And if you want to have a Bible study on that later, I'll show you. In God's Word, salvation is secure.
Yes.
It can never be taken from us. Praise
right.
God. That takes away all fear.
Amen. Amen.
So I think it's quite clear in these verses that we have an unpardonable sin, which is blaspheming the Holy Ghost. Amen. And so I don't think a saved person can do that.
No.
Now, have you felt like you've done it? Sure you have. Because you've turned the Holy Ghost off, if you will.
Right.
Where you've caused him to look in another direction in a way. Because you choose to sin
right.
by what the Holy Ghost is telling you not to do. Amen?
Amen?
So let's go to verse 11 and 12. So I was thinking about breathing out the Holy Spirit.
Right.
And so let's look at verse 11. And when they bring you into the synagogues and unto the magistrates and powers, take ye no thought how or what thing ye shall answer. Really?
Right.
Or what ye shall say. For the Holy Ghost shall teach you in the same hour what you ought to say.
Right.
Speaking to the disciples and a multitude of people.
Yep.
Running all around. Jumping on each other. Pushing their way. A throng of people. Trying to get to Christ. I guess they just wanted to see him. And there he is speaking. To me.
Right.
Speaking to you. What is it that's really God is so, let's say, deferred from Christ? What is it that's gotten us so caught up out there right now that we can't even focus on Christ doing something wonderful for us tonight?
Right.
I want to take you back to verse 4. Because this is the playground of Satan and his angels. Luke 12:4, and I say unto you, my friends. Listen to this, please, tonight, Christian. Be not afraid of them that kill the body.
Right.
And after that, have no more that they can do. 1 John 5:19 is real clear. And we know that we are God of God. And the whole world liveth, lieth in wickedness. James 4:4 says, ye adulterers and adulteresses, know ye not that friendship of the world is enmity with God, and whosoever therefore will be a friend, or will be a friend of the world, is the enemy of God. So God is making it clear. Where is my relationship?
Amen.
Am I an enemy with God? Am I living in a cloak of Christianity where somehow I think that as long as I put this thing on, I'm protected? And nonsense if you believe that. If you're saved tonight, God says he wants to take away the fear.
Amen.
But if you're in fear tonight of being found out, well, praise God for that. Maybe God's dealing with your heart about the sin that's in your life. Amen? Maybe God wants you to do something about this evening. I think there's a whole lot of words that Jesus Christ spoke to his disciples. And, of course, right before Jesus Christ went to the cross, died on Calvary, in John 15:18, he often said, if the world hate you, you know that it hated me before it hated you. I'm sorry, 15:9. Did I say 5? 15:18. Bear with my brain. Am I all right?
Yeah.
Amen. Amen. When the Lord gets a hold of it, it works out good.
Amen.
If the world hate you, you know that it hated me before it hated you.
Right.
If you were of the world would love his own. But because you are not of the world, but I have chosen you out of the world, therefore the world does what?
Thank you.
What a great statement. Amen?
Yep.
So, I don't know if I've had any difficulty with the world lately. Hating me for being a child of God. what's about to come.
Yes, sir.
I'm sure that sooner or later I'm going to be kicked out of the synagogue.
Right.
You know? Sooner or later, there's going to be folks that will not want to accept the message that God has laid upon my heart, even as I have given it to you tonight. There's two things that God wants to leave with us this evening. And I believe it's important in light of any opposition or problems you might be having. And that is when it comes to fear, we ought to fear God.
That's right.
Amen?
Amen.
And there's two things, fear God and trust God.
Amen.
So we can leave here tonight with a fear of God, a real fear of God.
Right.
That soon, if we don't clean it up, He's going to open it up.
Amen.
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 That is, we're a child of God.
Right.
If we're not a child of God, we don't have to worry, because we'll be screaming out in hell for all eternity.
That's right.
And that's not good.
Amen.
Amen. Let's stand and some close prayer. Father, forgive me where my flesh likes to take over. Lord, I pray that the message that you've laid out before us tonight is that, Lord, you spoke to us in the multitude of everything that's going on in our life. And Lord, you care less about how many followers you have. Lord, you care less how big your church is. Lord, those are not the things that you care about. You care about our souls. And yes, Lord, you certainly want a lot of people to be saved, and you want a lot of people to be with you in heaven. And you made it so easy for us.
Yes.
Now, Lord, you've made it easy for us tonight, even to bring before you those things that are happening in our closets that need to be revealed to you, to let you know, to let us know that we're not fooling you, Lord.
Amen.
So, Lord, let that be tonight. Lord, if you want us not saved, Lord, let them come to know the Christ that I am. Lord Jesus Christ is your Savior. In his precious name, Jesus Christ.
Amen. Amen. Hymn number 300. 301.